All right. I'm so happy to be back here doing what I love. It's a beautiful, warm summer evening. And been away for a couple days just trying to catch my breath as we move here into August. Moving time. The intense feeling now is one of really needing to bail on this whole situation that is presenting itself now in the world. The Iron Curtain is coming down, the Iron Curtain of totalitarianism, at an extreme level that we a global level, something we've never experienced before on this planet. It is that bad. And just there's this intense desire to bail, time to bail, you know, bail on this situation. It's like, let's say there's a massive earthquake out in the ocean. And you get a call on your cell phone, you know, and someone tells you, there's been this huge earthquake and that tsunami has been generated. And so you'd say, okay, wow, I better warn these people to get to higher ground. There's a tsunami coming right for us. And so you spend your time desperately trying to reach people, saying, people, listen, believe me, there's a tsunami coming. Get up to higher ground right now. And everybody's lying on the beach and they're so happy and they're so relaxed and they're saying, no, forget it. I just want to sit here and just relax and I don't want to move. Everything should be fine. Don't worry. Just don't worry. Be happy, right? Have fun. Enjoy life. So, you know, they don't respond. And so at what point does a first responder, a watchdog, at what point are they justified in themselves going to higher ground? Because they realize, hey, if we stay here any longer down on the beach warning people, we're going to get hit by the tsunami ourselves, which is not right at all. And you have to wonder about this whole situation, and I do, because people on the beach are just incredibly stupid. Are they willfully staying there for some reason? So what I have seen on this planet here, as I've tried to warn people about what is to come, is that my best observation and conclusion is that people are willfully not paying attention because they actually agree with the purpose of the coming troubles, which is really a planetary sacrifice. They actually agree with it. And what they're by, maybe they say, well, we'll listen to you, etc., but they don't go to higher ground, as it were. And the purpose I've seen of this world, of trying to bring help into the world at this time, is literally to try to trap that help here in this world so that the help will also succumb to sacrifice, because the whole plan of existence is to annihilate itself. And out of that annihilation is supposedly going to come a rebirth, a new reality with a spirit being prime creator. And but the annihilation has to be total. So those who are loyal to the purpose of existence are literally trying to lead everybody else down the primrose path to make sure that they also face destruction. And if they see anybody that they feel is going to escape, they then play the game of how do we get them to sacrifice so they're destroyed too. And if they see people, those who really want to help free others from sacrifice, they say, well, okay, how do we get them, lure them into the trap? And what they do is they pretend to be interested in the help. Like, oh, yeah, I'm really interested in the help. Can you tell me? Can you explain to me? Then they start asking all these time-wasting, delaying questions, which is what I've experienced in life. Not talking about the viewers of these videos that I make. But I'm talking, my observations are general about the whole situation here in this world with a lot of experience. Is you can tell by the questions that are asked whether the questions are really designed because they desperately want to get safety, or are they designed for the purpose of delay? Very easy to tell. And, you know, you, so most questions in the world are simply designed for delay, to try and keep helpers here, call them whatever you want to call them, light workers, helpers, advisors, enlighteners, reassurers of truth, sages, saints, gurus, avatars, etc., pundits, sages, etc., etc. They want to keep them here by pretending interest, pretending to be interested in what they have to say, but they're not. They're just, you can tell by the questions, they're just, they don't ask questions that are on point, that are genuine inquiry. They simply do not get into genuine inquiry. Run into a slight issue here. Okay. So, for some reason, the video has just disappeared here. And it's freezing up. Okay. Don't know why. Hopefully, okay. Hopefully, we're back. They don't a ask questions that come from genuine inquiry. It's just completely apparent. It's completely apparent. It's a stalling game, hoping that they can keep us here long enough so that we suffer the same destruction that they want to suffer themselves. And they believe that their own destruction of the, what they call their identity, which is just the various form energy bodies that they have projected in their imagination to represent what they really are, which is spirit. Those energy bodies are supposedly going to be destroyed. And they think that through the destruction of these energy bodies, physical, etheric, the astral, the emotional, the mental, the causal, various bodies of energy bodies, subtle, some subtle to gross. They believe that they're going to be reborn as prime creators, something greater than spirit. And this is just the price that they have to pay for it. And they know that this plan makes no sense at all. It makes no sense from the very beginning, but the only way to at least hold on to this plan is to say it's got to be total. Every aspect of this dream, this projection of imagination has to be annihilated. All the whole symbolic scenario of existence, everything has to be annihilated without exception. So this ideology can't stand the idea of some aspect or getting away, slipping away. See? So of course they're going to pretend, oh, we're so interested in your spiritual teaching, tell us what you know, etc., etc. And that's just a stalling technique. The real devotees of truth and freedom, etc., are intensely interested in truth and pursue it with this, with their own intelligence and intuition, etc. And they're not going to waste much time on stupid questions of stalling questions. Their questions are going to be, like living type of things that are full of potential to clarify, like that. So we are an experience. When I say we need to bail out, we really need to bail on the situation now. Is get to higher ground. It's really time to get to higher ground. Most of it, most definitely. I'm just, I just feel in my gut just a feeling of fear. Fear of what is to come in this world, and realizing that those who insist on truth are on the losing side of history, of existence at this point, most severely so. For me, if I'm going to lend my support to anything, then whoever is asking me to lend my support has got to make their case to me. Okay, to me. Not make their case to some group of rabble and then direct the rabble to go after me with the pitchforks, Because I do not want to be persuaded, or my support cannot be won from at the barrel of a gun. Okay? Cannot be won that way. And what I find in this world is the totalitarian mindset of this world is simply not even considering trying to win the support of reason and intelligence, etc. It's all being done with great emotion and hysteria and intimidation and extreme pressures and deceitful tactics that are not respectful of intelligence and clarity and wisdom. So the cases are not being made at all. The cases in this world, the way the world's going, is at the barrel of a gun. That's how policy is being made now on this planet. And that is simply horrible. That is no way to win my support or the support of anyone who's deeply caring about truth and their own freedom, you see. Because I'll tell you another thing. There's not a single person on this planet who doesn't really hate existence. This whole scenario of vulnerability, of loss, of forgetfulness of what we are. Everybody hates it, okay? It's just very few are willing to admit this. Very few, because they're terrorized. Because they've been intimidated. Severely intimidated. This whole dream is like spirit is intimidating itself. Spirit is cowed by its own nightmare. You see? Spirit is terrifying itself. And there's precious few aspects of spirit that are willing or able to stand up and tell the truth here. Extremely rare and very difficult. And it's tough the nerves, because you can feel the intimidation and the feeling like, you know, this is a very dangerous thing to do. You're going to be on the wrong side of history, as it were, the losing side of the whole thing. Not true. Because existence itself is a losing proposition entirely. So if you're on the side of truth, reality, God the prime creator, and spirit, and love, and eternal life, and endlessness, if you're on that side, you're on the winning side always, inherently. There is no loss for that side. There is no vulnerability. But to just now, I came across something very interesting today. And it wasn't this field of sunflowers, but it was this dynamic that those who want to keep this sacrifice going and get as many as possible, they look at all those who are slaving away here and suffering and don't really want it, but aren't saying anything. And they say, well, they're just crazy. They're crazy anyway, so what's the difference? In other words, and I said, no, my feeling was, no, they're not crazy. Nobody here in this world is really crazy. Intimidated, yes. That severe intimidation can show up as if one is crazy or stupid or something like that. And so, in looking at this world, everybody looks like they want to go along with the sacrifice, that they don't really want freedom, that they're just somehow inherently too stupid to want any such thing. And so that it's justified to keep this enslavement going, enslavement to sacrifice, because those who are going along with it they're just crazy. See, that's how the ego works. It says we're just all crazy. I guarantee you, none of you are crazy. Intimidated, yes, but that's par for the course here. This world is a place of extreme intimidation. You know, and even I have to admit that I got intimidated here, which was a shock to me, because I was not easy to intimidate. I'm not someone who's easily intimidated at all. In fact, I was ferocious when I was younger, that no adult, no one could intimidate me. But the combined efforts of the planet in so many different ways eventually intimidated me. So, you know, if I can be intimidated, anyone can be intimidated here. And the fact that I've been able to bounce back to this shows that I did have a very robust resistance to intimidation. But the intimidation here is absolutely off the charts, and it's getting exponentially, quantumly worse. All this talk about quantum progress in the world and blah, 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 it's the opposite. It's simply quantum coercion that is taking place on this planet right now. Quantum coercion. The coercion and the intimidation and the pressure on this planet is taking quantum leaps. It's like that big old dark cloud on the right of this sunflower field here. It's just coming in. A massive, massive storm is coming in of coercion. And all the stormtroopers are here in the world that love to that feed off this coercion and the climate of fear that it produces, and it activates them, you know, and they're getting activated more and more and more. So that's why I say it is time to bail. It is absolutely time to bail. And I'm trying to prevail upon those who help us bail to, you know, do their thing. The whole plan on this planet is to bail on this situation. That's what Jesus talked about 2,000 years ago, is there will come a time to bail on this entire situation as the darkness gets too extreme and the intimidation becomes too extreme, and we realize, you know, the price we're paying for trying to help in this world is too steep a price. Now, we don't want to lose our freedom simply because we want to help. That's not right. Help, yes. Lose freedom, no. So any effort to help in this world is always set in the context, understanding the context of not risking the point of losing one's freedom or the sense of freedom. We can't ever lose our absolute freedom, but we can believe or become intimidated about it. Yes, we can become very intimidated about it. So nobody is obligated to continue to help out on this planet if the price they pay is to be beaten down into submission to the ego's plan of sacrifice. Nobody. So if anybody is so robust that they can remain here and nothing bothers them, well, more power to them. I tip my cap to them. I really do. But that doesn't mean that everybody should remain here, right? Because if you feel the situation is becoming too intimidating, you should bail. Okay? And what we're working on is what are the actual dynamics of bailing on this situation. The situation has gone too far. It's gone way too far, and it really is as described. You know, there are a lot of great prophets over the years who have accurately described what is taking place now. Very accurate. I tip my hat to all of them because they're right. They turn out to be very, very right. Now, of course, it's always hard to set dates from certain perspectives. I've experienced that in certain ways. Because how things work out here on the physical plane, it's not always easy to give pinpoint things from a distance. However, one can get the general ballpark, most definitely. So, how to bail on the situation, bail on the planet. I mean, if again, if anyone was really was not intimidated, everyone on this planet would bail. Everyone. Everyone would bail because they hate the scenario of vulnerability. Everybody hates this entire this scenario of vulnerability. Absolutely, they do hate it. And so they should bail. Everyone should bail. By the way, the sunflower field is that video is made available by the courtesy of 10 minutes to relax. YouTube, that's a YouTube user. YouTube channel, 10 minutes to relax. A lot of very, very nice videos there. They make as Creative Commons. So if you want to relax, I recommend you can go there. 10 minutes to relax. That's a number, 10 minutes, and then two is a number, and then relax. So everybody has the right to bail. Nobody, if again, if they weren't intimidated, they'd all say they hate this world. They hate the whole scenario of loss. They hate the universe. They hate vulnerability. Hate it. Can't stand it. And want nothing more except to be free of it and get back to reality, the lossless, invulnerable, majestic, serene, glorious reality. That is our home. We all want to get back to it. It is simply that this scenario of annihilation that existence is causing people to feel like, well, I better play it safe and play along with it for a while, and then eventually I'll get free of it. But I'm kind of too afraid that, you know, I want to maybe sure that it can't work before I bail on it. You know, I already know it cannot work. I'm positive it cannot work. So for me, I don't need to try to compromise with it at all. You know, most are trying some compromise because they're not sure if this plan is going to work or not. I know 100% for a fact it won't work. Experientially, I've seen it. I've seen how far it can go. Total chaos, symbolic chaos, but the chaos is still there. And nothing happens. There's no magical happening at all. None. It's just the realization, oh my gosh, this plan doesn't work. It's going to result in nothing. Complete waste of time. So I know it. That's why I'm not interested in compromise at all. I want to bail on it. But if you don't know for sure that this whole plan of existence won't work, then you're going to still be in dialogue and negotiation for some sort of compromise, saying, you know, look, you know, let's not put this to the test. Let's come up with some stable compromise so we won't, you know, keep going down that path of total annihilation. Okay, what else can you do? Of course. But when you find out that it can't work, you're in a different boat altogether. So I've been in a different boat altogether for since 1978, when I experienced it, the end of the path of existence, and seeing the attempted annihilation of existence only results in this symbolic chaos, this total chaos, but that's only symbolic, and that's all. Nothing happens. Reality, and I look, the reality is still there, it's completely unaffected, and my consciousness, my awareness, my spirit just rejected this chaos, saying, I don't want that. That's what I'm supposed to want. No way, no way, no way. There was zero appeal to it. Zero appeal. When you get to the point of total chaos, which is symbolic, and everything is complete, there's no order whatsoever and no external point around which to develop any order. So it's just this endless chaos. That's what I saw. And I said, there's nothing there that I want at all. Completely zero interest in it. And complete rejection. Okay, that's it. So there's nothing there I want. So there's no compromise needed. It's not like the ego is holding some Trump hand, you know. Is this gone? No, it's still got to work its way through. The ego is not holding any Trump hand whatsoever. It is, has got nothing. It's got nothing because what it has is this total symbolic chaos, and that is, you don't want it. You don't want it. So I said to the ego, okay, ego, you are telling me that your path is the right one, so show me what you got. And the ego then led me to this total chaos, and I said, you know what? I don't want it. I don't want it. So that's it. And that's all the ego has. So bailing on existence is being on the right side of truth. It is the right thing to do, because what existence has to offer you, you don't want. But you're not sure of that yet. Some are not sure. If you are sure, then you are going to bail for sure. You're going to be very adamant. You see, back to the tsunami analogy. The people on the beach there, you know, let's say they want to leave. Again, there's some who are so intimidated, they want to entrap everyone. There are others who want to leave, but they're too intimidated to leave. They're too frightened because they say, you know, no, maybe existence can destroy itself entirely, and in doing so, wipe out reality. And so we want to stop that somehow. So we want to negotiate a settlement with the ego. So we have to stay here and keep negotiating. We're doing the right thing. So there's those who want to leave, but they need to negotiate a settlement first with the ego. And of course that'll never happen because the ego is just stalling. Those who are negotiating with the ego, they are the ones who are being entrapped by the ego. The ego has no capacity to broker any deal because what it has is nothing that we want. So what position is it in to make a deal? It knows it has nothing to make a deal with. Therefore, when it's bargaining with you, it is only trying to entrap you into total destruction. That's all it really wants. Because it knows it doesn't have anything to make a deal with, and that you're going to discover that if it keeps bargaining, you'll eventually see it's got nothing. So it wants to destroy you before you find that out. Destroy all your energy bodies. It's a very, very wicked thing. But it's also completely impotent, has no effect on reality whatsoever. So those of you who are sitting on the beach, you know, trying to negotiate a deal, say, give it up, go to higher ground. You're simply being entrapped, that's it. The ego has nothing that you want, nothing. Not even the tiniest shred does the ego have. This whole scenario of existence, this planet, this universe, all the people here, they have absolutely nothing that you want. The bodies, in other words, all the energy bodies, when I say people, all the energy bodies, subtle to gross, have nothing that you want. Nothing. And never will. But why are we in dialogue with that? With that which has nothing that we want? What for what purpose? Can they add something to us? Our position? Do they have something to give us? We give something to them, they give something to us. If they have nothing that we want, how can they give something to us? How can they add to our riches at all? The answer is they cannot. They cannot add. Existence cannot add anything to us. What we are, the riches of our home, can add nothing to it. Zero. So why are we in dialogue? Because we're intimidated. Because we think that maybe, plausibly, this plan can work and destroy reality. By existence destroying itself, reality will somehow magically be destroyed, and then existence will have a rebirth as a new creation. So we're hedging our bets. We're intimidated by this. What reason does, the voice of reason, is enable us to see through this lie. And then we realize it's all just a sham. It's just a bluff. Existence is just bluffing. That's all it is. But it's an extremely clever, elaborate, creatively imagined bluff. Okay, so it's not easy for anyone to truly know that it's a bluff. To some degree, we're intimidated. Very few. There's only been a few in this world who were not intimidated in the slightest bit. And one of my teachers, all of my teachers were not intimidated at all. Jesus, Ananda Maima, Ramana Maharshi, none of those were the slightest bit intimidated. They knew the ego, this world has absolutely nothing. Ananda Maima said that everyone in the world is frantically chasing after nothing. Not realizing that it's nothing. What we're really chasing after is some kind of compromise. Because we think, whoa, wait a minute, we don't want reality to be destroyed. And maybe existence might accomplish that. So let's cut a compromise between reality and illusion. You know, that's like, let's cut a compromise between truth and lies. And so we're all, you know, working on that. Because we're intimidated, we're worried that this plan might work. But so, all that the teachers can do is to assure you that it cannot work. There's not the slightest possibility that it can ever work, because it has absolutely nothing that you want. Existence, nothing. And just simply reassure that, because the experience has to come from within. Like the experience I had of total chaos acted out symbolically, because it has to. Reality can't be in chaos, so chaos must be symbolic. That came within. That was my own experience that I had. And then the teachers just reinforced, yeah, they said, trust in that experience. Follow that. Believe in it. What we're telling you is true. Now you know. That's what happened. And I said, oh my gosh. What these teachers have been saying, now I see, it's true. What they're saying is true. And so gradually the intimidation has been wearing off, but I tell you, the intimidation is here. Here is almost total, you know. It's incredible. So, you know, people are afraid to speak up, really afraid to say how they really feel, afraid to voice their allegiance to truth, afraid to voice their true desire for salvation, for safety, to voice what they really want, which is to escape sacrifice. That's what everyone really wants. They want to escape sacrifice. They want to escape the place of sacrifice, too, where sacrifice seems to be possible. They want to escape that. They want freedom from that, and yet they're too scared because they think it'll ruin negotiations with the ego if they give voice to any of that. See, the ego plays this game that it's a compromiser, even though it's 100% not a compromiser because it has nothing to compromise on at all, nothing. So the ego is not a compromiser, but it plays the game very well of being a compromiser. So it says, hey, as long as you're not talking too radical, not talking too much about freedom and all this, then we can talk. But if you start getting too, you know, 100% and too far out there, then you're going to hurt these negotiations we're involved in. So I just have to say, it's all a trick. The ego is bluffing. It's not in any negotiations with any of us. It is as it pretends to be. It is frantically working to drop the Iron Curtain on all of us, entrap all of us in this horrific scenario of sacrifice. That's its only intention. That's it. Has no other intention whatsoever, and yet it pretends to be in earnest negotiations with us, with spirit. What a liar, what a deceiver. Nothing but deception, total deception. It's not the slightest bit interested in any sort of compromise. It's just leading us along, delaying, delaying, delaying until it can spring its trap. That's it. Yeah, the darkness is coming on strong right now. Really. It is chilling. You know, it is really chilling. So, you know, to go from there to a certitude of safety is the way to go, because then that gives a sense of optimism. So we kind of fluctuate between this feeling of chilling dread and great optimism. You might say the world, it's the situation in the world is somewhat manic depressive in a lot of ways right now, because the worse the dread is, of course, the greater the relief when we realize, oh, we're going to escape it, and that's just a oh, wonderful feeling of relief, and so we're so happy about that, so optimistic. But then, if you go back into the trap and thinking you're going to be trapped, then there's this horrible feeling of dread, a terrible feeling. So, you know, now we're kind of oscillating between those two. So that's just normal for the times, just normal for the times. As this storm comes in, we're transfixed by it and thinking, oh my gosh, I don't want to get caught by this. What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? And then when you realize, wait, there's a way, a Passover principle. There's a way for this to all pass me over, and I can be untouched by it forever. Then the relief just comes like an enormous relief. And then we're so optimistic, so it's wonderful. So you might think, well, I went from this great optimism to into just this extreme dread, and then I'm back to this great optimism. That is normal for these times. Very normal. So don't worry about it. Just realize that bounce is simply there right now, because the situation is becoming so intense, so fraught with consequence, as it were, at a certain level. Again, nothing can happen to reality, so there's no consequence to reality. But as long as we still believe in belief, then it's full of consequences for belief, for our belief, for our faith, and for that, it's full of consequences. It's like, are we going to continue to dream a drastically terrible nightmare, or are we going to have very pleasant, happy dreams? That's kind of, you know, the consequences. Both dreams are equally unreal. But while we're sleeping, we don't know that. So for those who, you know, are still sleeping, unaware that this is all just a dream, then we're in a very consequential time right now. Extraordinarily so. August is moving time. It's moving month. Guess when we have to get moving on this. We do not want to go into this autumn, the last 4 months of the year, September, October, November, December. We do not want to go into those months without a strong head of steam away from the situation towards bailing out. I recently saw a video on YouTube of this massive glacier. There was this boat in a bay, and there's a huge glacier suddenly broke off into the ocean, and this tsunami started heading towards the boat, and they saw it, and they turned around, and they were going as fast as they could away from that tsunami, filming it at the same time. It was amazing. And eventually the tsunami caught up with them and hit the boat real hard, but they managed to survive. They outran it, so to speak. It had lessened. By the time the tsunami hit them, it had lessened to the point where it didn't, you know, destroy the boat, flip it up, sink it. So why? Because they saw the tsunami, saw the glacier fall, saw the tsunami coming, and realized we have to turn around, outrun this thing. So we need to, right now in August, get going and outrun this thing before it really hits us. Now, last year I said that there's some very severe stuff happening in the world, and gave advance warning so that we could use this next year, you know, like starting in like late November, late October, early November, we'd use this cycle of a year to outrun the tsunami. The tsunami's coming. It's like the glacier has already fallen into the bay, and a tsunami is coming towards us, and we need to turn that boat around and go as fast as we can in the opposite direction. So warnings aren't any good unless they're given in advance, unless they give us enough time to outrun the problem. So of course I had to give advance warnings out and get people tuned in to what's going on, and realize at the subtle level these things have happened already. At the subtle level, you know, like the glacier crossing into the bay is like a subtle event. The tsunami heading towards us is a subtle event, but when it reaches us, it's no longer a subtle event. You see, that's how it works. So in existence here in this dense physical situation, we don't recognize stuff until it hits us. Then we say, oh, this is real. This has happened now. No, it may have happened quite some time ago. It's just that the tsunami didn't reach you and hit you yet. So you're thinking, we're thinking, oh, that other stuff, you know, it just happened now. And so, like, you know, giving out advance warnings, people are saying, well, nothing's happened. Yes, it has. In the subtle realm, it has already happened. It's already happened, and the tsunami is racing towards us. And when it hits us, we'll say, oh, it's happening right now, my gosh. So that's only then do we really say something is really happening. Even though, no, it's already happened. So by giving out advance warning, which many have done, some, you know, like Jesus, 2,000 years of advance warning. Others have given out, you know, hundreds of years, some 50 years warning. Some have given out 20 year. Some have given out 15, 10 year. You know, 5 year warning, 3 year, year warning. I've been working on this, you know, 50 year warning, basically. But continuing to increase the warnings until I gave a year warning back in the end of October. Actually, I started my warning July of 2010 on YouTube saying, you know, and then I said from late October, I said, you know, you really got to now realize that the situation is absolutely dire. And you need to outrace the tsunami. And it's possible. It is possible. We are trying to outrace the tsunami. And it may catch up to us to a certain degree. But again, the farther away, the further distance you are from the epicenter, the less intense the tsunami will be. The less intense the troubles are. So every bit of effort you make lessens the impact of the situation upon you. That is, and that's great news. That's why I say right effort is all important. Right effort is all important. Because right effort enables you to, for the situation to become less intense. And some are transfixed by the situation. Many of the world, most, are transfixed by it. Don't take their lack of action for intelligence. Take it to mean they're transfixed by it. They are deer in headlights. You know, they're staring right at it, and you say, hey, come on. And they keep staring right at it. They're just transfixed. Transfixed by the whole thing about sacrifice, too afraid to oppose it. Because they, you know, they want to have their cake and eat it too. They say, well, yeah, reality is still there and real, but it might not always be there. So I kind of want to go along with the plan of sacrifice, because maybe it'll get me something, a backup, just in case reality is destroyed. I want to have a backup. That's, you know, why they're transfixed. They're not sure either way. So they cannot move out of harm's way. Cannot do it. And so you cannot spend forever trying to help those who are transfixed, because once the sacrificial wave hits them, boom, you can't even talk to them anymore at all. So best thing is to do is to maintain your viability to help others by getting out of harm's way. That's the best thing to do by far. And but you know, many, in my estimation of this world, most are still transfixed. And most are trying to have their cake and eat it too, trying to have it both ways, trying to play along with the ego, the plan of loss, thinking that, you know, maybe it might be necessary to have this in their back pocket just in case loss works, just in case reality can be destroyed. They want to make sure that they are going along with the ego's program and that they've done their sacrificial work. That's where most are at. And so they're not willing to get out of harm's way, because they don't see that that's the best move to make. They want to hedge their bets, as it were. But again, in my case, seeing that the ego's plan does not work and it only leads to this symbolic total chaos, this horrible experience, that's all it's got. No way do I want to continue here pretending, looking for some bargain. There's no bargain here. Ego has no bargain to give you. Want to bail on the situation, as it were. So, meaning go in the other direction as fast as possible. Get out of harm's way as fast as possible. And August is, again, moving time for that. It's the time to make haste away from the harm. So we have a head of steam going into September, October, November, December. Things are going to get very nasty. They're already very nasty. You know, November and December, look out. You want to be far, far away from the situation by that time. And you want to be able to really distance yourself from the entire scenario of sacrifice at that time, because the final preparations will be made. You know, I was watching a video. Maybe I'll tell you, let's see where it is. In the video, I'll tell you about it. I'm thinking of putting up some way of helping you, a playlist or something that has certain videos in it that I feel that would be helpful for you. Some of the ones that I watch, in other words, some of my favorites. And you can go to maybe I'll put up like Christ Clarity favorite videos. And the videos that I think have benefit to help get you moving, I'll start working on that. I don't know how to publicize it. YouTube is very difficult now to publicize. They've put so many restrictions on things. It's just amazing. Limiting and hiding and just making the whole process of interacting, you know, it's so difficult. And who knows what's to come. Anyway, this video was about cremation in India on the ghats of Varanasi, banks of the Ganges. And they showed the whole process, putting the corpse there, the wood, everything, you know, just exactly how they do it. Well, it's like this world. This world is ready to go through this cremation, you know. The world wants to cremate itself. As if from that is something's going to be liberated from that. And so what does it do? It starts stacking all this wood and putting all these branches and flammable stuff, right? That's how this corpse was arranged, with all this wood, very flammable stuff, and then the fires. Once that all that stuff is surrounding and on top of the corpse, underneath, around, and on top, then someone starts lighting little fires all around, and then before you know it, you know, all the flames engulfing the corpse. It's like that in the world. The world is being prepared to be cremated by, and all this wood, all these situations are being placed around everywhere. And very flammable situations, very incendiary situations are being all set up. And then once they're all set up, you will have it will get lit in many, many little places. All these little fires will start being lit. Incendiary situations will be sparked. Spark, 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 spark. And the whole thing suddenly will catch fire. That is exactly what's going to happen. I said that there's a goddess of destructivity who is the orchestrator, the producer of this whole event. And she's on this planet right now somewhere. Well, I don't know whether it's subtle form or gross form. I'm not sure. I'm not sure. Could be in subtle form, subtle energy body, possible. And this whole thing is being orchestrated. It's being carried out very, very carefully, the same way care taken in cremating a corpse on the banks of the Ganges in Varanasi, putting all the wood. They're very careful, and they do it very carefully. They set everything up, and then they start lighting these little fires, sparking it. Same thing is happening on a global scale. All these situations around the planet are being set up, carefully set up to be inflammatory, and then they're going to be sparked at a certain time, and the planet will be just engulfed in the flames. And so you don't want to be, you don't want to be a corpse. You don't want to be cremated, because it gets you nothing. Again, no matter what the ego does, this whole plan of loss only results in this experience of total chaos. That's it. So you can be cremated, you know, infinite number of times. The outcome is still exactly the same. This symbolic total chaos. That's as far as it can possibly go. So why even go through any of this ridiculous path of sacrifice when that's all that's ever going to get you? If you could see what it is, the maximum you can gain from this, if you saw the maximum you could gain from all this, then you would just wouldn't go along with it at all. You'd say, that's absolutely crazy. I'm putting myself through all this terrible, insane nightmare for this? All for just this? And you'd say, no way. That's completely absurd. Which is why I'm saying it. I'm able to say it because I know it's absurd. Bailing on it because, you know, you're bailing on nothing. Really. Bailing on nothing. Again, existence has nothing that you want. Nothing. Absolutely zero. What you really want. It has all sorts of plausible wants. But even those plausible wants are only there to serve the purpose, because you believe that you can become prime creator, create a new reality, a separate reality, destroy the old reality, because you'd have to have a new one. It's all built upon that insane belief, magical belief, wishful thinking, whimsical belief. And if we realize that's impossible, then, you know, we would stop bargaining. We'd stop bargaining. And then we'd gain our courage, conviction, because we'd say, I don't care if the ego's mad with me. The ego has nothing to give me. You know, the ego, when you oppose the ego, what happens, the ego becomes furious. It goes on a total rant. Like you're bargaining in bad faith. How could you break off talks? How can you not accept what I have to offer? It just goes through this insane rant. And if you think that the ego has something to offer you, it'll terrify you, because you think, oh my gosh, the ego's now is not going to give me anything. The secret is, the ego has nothing to give you in the first place, so it's not going to give you anything anyway. So who cares about the ego's rant? Let it rant. It's not like you're afraid, like, oh, I need the ego to calm down so it won't go so far as to offer me nothing. I need to calm down, so I'll agree, you know, I'll try to calm the ego down and agree, say, okay, ego, I'll back off, you know. Now, this is probably still in that mode of Yeah, still there. So by backing off and saying, trying to calm the ego down, you believe that you're trying to prevent the ego from getting so angry and crazy that it'll just say, okay, I'm through with negotiating with you. I'm not going to give you anything. Deal's off forever. You're terrified of that. But if you know that the ego has nothing to give you in the first place, never will, it's completely bluffing. And who cares if the ego goes crazy and, shouting gibberish and stuff? You don't need to get the ego back in any kind of negotiating stance because it has nothing to give you. Never, doesn't matter how long you negotiate, it has nothing it will ever be able to give you. So who cares if the ego wants to? The ego will bluff and go crazy, pretend to be crazy, and, flipped out completely. He'll flip out completely. So, and try to terrify you that way. And you just realize that it's just a tactic it's using because it doesn't have anything to give in the first place. So who cares if the ego plays like it's totally insane? And you don't have to get it back to the bargaining table. No, there's nothing to bargain with the ego with at all. It has nothing. How can you even give the ego a seat at the bargaining table when it has absolutely nothing to give, ever? There's no position to be at the bargaining table. So if it wants to leave and go on, let it do it. I've had a number of times experiencing the ego's rant, and it was terrifying. Because you think, oh my gosh, I'm losing the opportunity to negotiate with this. I mean, this one is just furious, and they're gonna cut me a terrible deal. No, they can't even cut a terrible deal. It can cut no deal at all, none. Seeing that, I'm able to speak up in this way, whereas others, there's just no way they can. They can't speak up as adamantly because they're worried. They don't want to get the ego pissed off too much. They don't want to get an ego too angry. They're scared of that, scared of it. Because the ego really knows how to throw a tantrum, I'll tell you that. Definitely. That's the only thing it's got, really. It's got all this deceptive niceness and negotiating, it's like it's being real reasonable. And when you see through its lies and stalling tactics, then it throws its tantrum. That's its flip side, the other side of the coin. And it's very, very good at throwing tantrums. How's this recording? Okay. Yeah. Let me see if I can get this sunflower field back up. These videos have to kind of cycle. When I click off of them, they stop going, which they shouldn't, but they do. So we just have to go through this kind of end of the video scenario by 10 minutes to relax. Thank them for their use of their videos here. So we're, by this kind of talk, we're moving fast away from the tsunami of sacrifice, which is headed our way big time. It's on the subtle level still, but it is soon going to become apparent on the physical level. It's going to be apparent. And now they give this nice message, be here now. Maybe it should be flee here now. Flee from here now. It's really. Let's put that, flee from here now. Well, that is the truth. We saw in that Aurora, Colorado situation, a situation where the subtle level suddenly made its presence felt, goddess of destructivity is orchestrating it. And you had someone who was obviously split mind, schizophrenic, meaning they're under control of the subtle level in a bad way. And so they're not able to function effectively at this level of the dense level without the subtle level impinging and taking over their actions in a negative way. It's very bad. You can be aware of the subtle level in a positive way that it helps you, but you can also the destructive, subtle destructive forces, what they do is they gain access to people, split their minds as it were, and then the subtle level controls them and directs them to actions like this poor, this schizophrenic messed up entity being who is still a brother to all of us in spirit, but unfortunately the goddess of destructivity found a weak spot in him significant enough so that he she this could be orchestrated and he could be used like a Manchurian candidate to have the subtle level impinge upon the gross level. And this whole thing was symbolic, like that way, like as if we're watching a movie and suddenly the movie comes to life, like a character on the screen suddenly appears to us in real life, as it were, this dense physicality, and starts acting out the kind of actions that they would normally act out on the screen. You see that? The screen is like, a movie is like the subtle realm, and then the people in the movie theater is like the dense realm. And if the kind of activities that are taking place on the movie screen suddenly start taking place to the audience, that's what's called the subtle level impinging upon the gross level. Now, we're going to get into some more stuff here. Let us take a break here, just a short break, because this is starting to get very heavy. Okay. The term apocalypse means lift the veil. Lifting of the veil. Our veils. The apocalypse means a time when the veils are lifted. Okay? So when people say we're heading towards the apocalypse, what they mean is we're heading towards a time when the veils will be lifted. Now, what do we mean by the veils? It's that which prevents us from seeing other subtle other dimensions of energy. So when the veils lift, it's like right now we're seeing the gross world of energy. We'll be able to see subtle levels of energy. We'll also be able to see even grosser levels of energy, depending on our orientation. It's very important. And we are getting very close to the time. When people talk about 2012 and the apocalypse, end of the world, what they really mean is a lifting of the veils at that time. Meaning we'll be able to see, quote-unquote, the dead, the afterlife, the subtle realms. And the subtle realms have all sorts of stratifications. Again, some lifting of the veils will also result in seeing hellish realms, very terrible. Some will result in seeing very beautiful realms. Depends on your orientation. So it's very important when the veils are lifted and our sight, our perception, our experiencing takes on sort of a multi-dimensionality, at least in energetically, that we're oriented towards seeing the beautiful and ultimately the loss-free realm, the lossless realm is the real goal. And we're not oriented towards the darkness and seeing the realms of sacrifice and loss and all that horrible stuff. This whole digital high technology thing is actually being used to break down the veils, to lift the veils. That's what it's actually being used for. And it can be used positively if you're guided by spirit. If you're not guided by spirit, it will turn out to be a very bad situation, very, very bad. All these movies that people are watching is literally they are rehearsing the apocalypse, the lifting of the veils, of what they're going to see. Because when it lifts, people will think they're going crazy, because they will be seeing so much more than they're seeing now. This, all the subtle stuff in the subtle realm, there's this horrible war and sacrifice and battle and nastiness going on. Terrible, terrible storm. And and all these video games, everything that people are immersing themselves in with high technology has made this very possible to immerse oneself in to an extreme extent. And that literally thins the veils out to the subtle realm. But most of it is oriented towards extreme conflict, extreme violence, extreme wickedness, extreme darkness. And so it's getting people ready to lift the veil on hell, as really the hellish realms, as it were. Realms of extreme sacrifice, you know, wicked, extreme mayhem. And what we're doing is we're working hard to lift the veil on what I call you can call it paradise, the kingdom of heaven, the loss-free realm, the lossless realm, the immaculate realm, where there's no loss, there's no vulnerability whatsoever. Some call it the real world. Jesus said to paradise, he said to the thief that was dying on the cross with him, he said, you'll be with me in paradise. It's paradise, meaning nothing is lost. There's no vulnerability, there's no loss taking place whatsoever there. No death, no sickness, no dying, no accidents. It's a extraordinarily beautiful place and awesome place. And a place of remembrance. More than anything, it's a place of remembrance, remembering what we really are and what our true home is really all about. And so it's a place of euphoria and bliss. And the veil on that will lift too. We can lift that. We're doing that here. These videos are doing that, helping us lift the veil. So the apocalypse can mean different things for different people depending on where they're oriented, what's their orientation. When the veil's lift, people will be pulled towards their orientation very rapidly. That's why it's so important to be aligned towards the lost free realm. There's an entire realm that has natural forms, forms that we're familiar with, but none of that has ever suffered any loss whatsoever. It is just absolutely immaculate, and there's no way to get that feeling here in this world of that supreme immaculateness of the real world. And that veil on that will lift also at 2012. 2012 is the apocalypse, the end of 2012, going into 2013. That's the lifting of the veils, and we're getting very close to that now. And what you're seeing now is the negative, the vicious stuff, the plan of loss on the subtle level is now beginning to impinge, doing everything it possibly can. What the world is trying to do is build the bridge into that subtle level so the veils drop, and at that time we will feel overwhelmed by a totalitarianism. That's why we got this nervous feeling, like we better hurry up. And people wondering, how can such terrible stuff happen in this world? It happens by the lifting of the veil, the apocalypse, lifting of the veil to the subtle realms. This will be the gross subtle, where all this sacrifice is concentrated, heavily concentrated. It's also, there are some of the subtler realms to sacrifice, but not as intensified, as concentrated. Okay, and when the veil on that lifts, then people will really start to go crazy and act out, react to that, and they can't no longer distinguish the differentiation between this world and the subtle world. It'll all kind of blend into one, and they will feel as if they're in this absolute nightmare battle, etc. It'll be absolutely horrible, horrible. This is what it vaguely says in the Bible, that the dead will rise, you'll see the dead, and all this kind of thing. That's a symbolic thing. No, skeletons are not literally going to come flying out of the graves and things like that. But what I think that they're talking about is you'll see those who have passed on, you'll see them, because they're in the subtle levels right now, subtle levels of energy. Some of them, but others have dropped their subtle energy bottles, energy bodies, and are ready to reincarnate again, are some who have free themselves from the cycles of reincarnation, appearing in those subtle levels. They're not bound by the cycles at all. They're able to wrap themselves up in energy bodies and appear in these subtle levels. Even they can even appear here in the gross level. I don't know if that'll happen or if they're just going to appear in the subtle levels, but we are headed towards the apocalypse. Okay, Armageddon refers to a massive battle that will supposedly is going to take place in the Middle East. Okay, that's Armageddon. And that Armageddon, though, is not going to take place until the lifting of the veils. The apocalypse happens first. And in the lifting of the veils, then all that subtle realm, the very gross, negative, sacrificial, intense sacrificial part of the subtle realm blends in with this world, and everybody's perception and psyche, etc., becomes, reacting to all of that, and then that brings about the world conflagration, world battles, etc., Armageddon. But first, the apocalypse comes, which is a lifting of the veils. I used to be able to see the subtle world clear as day, clear as day. And then the veil descended, and I lost sight of it, which caused me extreme upset. I've been trying to get back ever since. I haven't been able to. So I absolutely know for a fact that there are subtle realms. No question about it. I saw the subtle realms. Saw everything that was happening there. All the subtle bodies, subtle entities moving about, intersecting this planet here in many different ways. So I know it's there. And when the veil lifts at the apocalypse, that subtle levels will become apparent again. But what we want is to head towards the lost free realm. realm, the kingdom of heaven realm, which we have every right to. But absolutely, that is our inheritance. We are completely entitled to that. Everyone is. Everyone is. Except we're still trying to make deals with the ego because we're kind of afraid that its plan of sacrifice might work at some point eventually. So we want to still stay on the ego's good side to come to an agreement, say, you know, that it won't take everything all the way. If we just, this is what we do. We bargain with time. Okay, we say, look, we'll go through one more sacrificial round of death and all this destruction, etc. If you then also decide to give up the final round, your final round of final destruction, if you give that up, we'll go through with some of it. And the ego says, okay, I'll make that deal. But does the ego make good on its agreement? No. Because then you'll find yourself back one more birth, and then once again, the ego will insist sacrifice of you. And you say, wait a minute, that last sacrifice, the last one, and the ego said, no. And then you get another negotiation session, and then eventually you get to the point where you say, okay, I'll go through one more if you really, really promise this time to give up the final round of sacrifice. And the ego will say, okay, this time I really promise. And then you go through another round of sacrifice. And then you go through another cycle of rebirth, and the same thing plays out over and over again. It's the exact same thing that's playing out. You want this to be the last round go around. The ego battles with you, saying no. And finally the ego says, okay, got me over a barrel. All right, I'll agree. I'll forego but the last cycle of that if you are loyal to one more round of sacrifice. And you say, okay, done deal. Go through another round of sacrifice. And then reborn again, thing all over again. And you say, wait a minute, the ego, you lied to me. You told me the last time was the last, you see? And the benefit I had was I remember my previous lives. I said, wait a minute, you promised me that the previous lives, that was the last go-round. And now here you are again negotiating with me? What are you talking about? You're a liar and deceiver. You broke your word. And then at that point, the ego got really mad. Really mad. So discovering your previous lives and realizing that you had agreement that was your last one, and you're back here again, you say, wait a minute, somebody's, you know, breaking their promise. It's the ego that is breaking its promise. It has no choice but to break its promise, because it can't hold back on anything, and it doesn't have anything you want. It has to try and push this through all the way. And so it's easy for the ego to say, oh yeah, okay, sure, I won't go through the last round of sacrifice, no problem. It's easy. It's got nothing to lose, the ego. It can promise you anything you want. All it wants is for you to go through one more round of sacrifice, and then you'll be reborn, and then it wants you to go through one more and one more. So it'll say whatever you want to hear just to agree to one more round. That's all it's got. That's all that it has. So if you agree, no more rounds. That's it. Time's up. No more bargaining over time. You got nothing. I've already seen what you're that. Of your efforts, which is nothing, total chaos, which is nothing I want. So forget it. No more bargaining. Then you're in a better position to help out if you can get to that point. So the apocalypse is nearly upon us. The lifting of the veils is nearly upon us. And traditionally, the end of 2012 is said to be that time. And I wouldn't doubt that for a bit. I'm not going to be held to it. You know, predictions in time are not supposed to be seen as 100, you know, no one should expect that they're going to be 100% accurate. That's ridiculous. But, you know, ballpark is a very good thing. And so the end of 2012 is a very good ballpark time, as it were, to expect a lifting of the veils around that time. It has to do with all sorts of various factors. Who knows, cosmic alignments, et cetera, et cetera. All the factors, but there are those who, it seems to be, everything is headed in that direction very clearly. It's like an enormous storm is almost upon you, and you know it's either going to rain in 1 hour, 10 minutes, or an hour. You know, some you know, it's going to rain very soon. You may not be sure exactly, you know, is it 10, 15 minutes, 20, half an hour, you know, I don't know exactly, but it's going to be very soon. And so the lifting of the veils, maybe we can lift the veils prior to the lifting of the dark, the veil that covers the darkness, which is going to freak everybody out. Because you become aware of the subtle realm. You see all these subtle entities and what they're doing. and you know, freak most people out, really. Because I remember what I used to be able to see, and what I've almost forgotten. And you know, there are all sorts of entities and energies and energy bodies doing all sorts of stuff. Call them ETs, call them angels, and then of all different types of energy entities involved in, you know, all sorts of agendas and stuff that's going on. And you know, the darkness, the terrible storm and strife, storm and drong, and all of this crud that's in the subtle realms, you know, this extreme crud. If you were to look at the subtle realm surrounding the world, the realm that's holding the sacrificial intent, it would just be like this enormous thunderstorm that is just dark, 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 ominous to the ultimate extent, you know, flashing out intense lightning. It'd be like that. So, you know, that's the apocalypse is almost upon us, lifting of the veil. And we want to be able to dismiss all this nonsense and let it pass us by understanding the Passover principle, which is non-resistance to evil, to darkness, to sacrifice, to loss, to vulnerability. Simply the complete dismissal of it as being nothing but a dream, has no meaning, no consequence, no reality. It holds nothing that I want. That's a powerful one. It holds nothing that I want. So I don't need to choose between different forms of nothing. And then realize that by perfect defenselessness, all of this has to pass us by. Has to. Because it has to seek for defenses, which to it mean value. Something that potential loss, that thing is being protecting. No protection, it sees no potential loss, and therefore has to pass it by. It's only interested in loss. It's like a vast black hole that is simply swallowing up everything, and its purpose is to simply cause total loss. So it's seeking out that which is being protected, which means value to it. It only sees value in defensiveness. The reality doesn't need any protection. It can't suffer any loss. So loss can only take place in symbols, and symbols not being real have to be, to have any value, imaginary value or meaning, has to be defended, protected. The loss has to be protected. So this black hole of loss is simply looking again for defensiveness. If there's no defensiveness, it will pass you by, because it'll see nothing there, nothing there. And it won't be able to exert any attraction, and you can't pull you in any way. Perfect defensiveness, defenselessness, perfect defenselessness is the perfect defense, the perfect safety. Defenselessness is the perfect safety. So that's what we're aiming for, is to give up this feeling of value. There's something of value in the world. When I stop reading A Course in Miracles, and I ask what's next, because I think I said that's enough. I've internalized. I understand what's being said here. So what's next? And then I got the direction. It says, examine your valuing of this world. And I've done that for the last 15 years. Examine your valuing of this world, because there's really nothing here of any value. So I've gone about doing that. And by doing that, then that helps lessen defensiveness. Because why defend this world? Why put up defenses to protect something of value when there's nothing of value here? That's crazy. If you really see it. And, you know, this whole path of examining one's value of the world has really unfolded amazingly. I've been put in situations that are you know, would represent high value for this world, really high value, and basically seen, this is boring, this isn't any real value at all. Why would I want to give up heaven, my home, like the kingdom of heaven, for this? That's crazy. Why would I want to sell my spirit out for this? There's nothing here. It's all vulnerable. Just vulnerability. It's just a pretty form of vulnerability. All we see here in everything here all things here, including all bodies, just forms of vulnerability. And all we're choosing is among different forms of vulnerability, of loss. And, you know, a pretty body is just a pretty form of loss. And what is that? Pretty form of loss? Is that what we want? Is that what I want? A pretty form of loss? No. I don't want any form of loss at all. None. Zero. Let's take another slight break and I can drink some water here. I'll go back to this sunflower thing and activate. Keep it looping. It seems to have... Is it going? Don't want any loss. Don't want any loss. Get my voice here. The ego only asks us, what form of loss do we want? Okay? That's all that it holds out to us. And we're bargaining with the ego. From its standpoint, it thinks we're insane, but it thinks it's trying to help us out of this insanity. And it thinks it's being so fair and kind to us, and it's saying, what form of loss do you want? What form of sacrifice do you want? What kind of costume do you want to wear to your funeral pyre? Is all that it's really asking us, trying to determine. It thinks it's very benevolent and very spiritual, and it's intensely engrossed in determining what kind of costume we want to wear to our funeral pyre as we're burned alive, as it were. That's all. That's all it is trying to determine. What form of loss do you want? What form of sacrifice do you want? And I tell the ego, I don't want any form of sacrifice. None. Zero. I don't want any form of loss. None. Zero. And the ego says, ah, you're not bargaining in good faith. You must be insane. I say, no, ego, I must be sane and you must be insane. And the ego says, well, that's not fair. We need to compromise on this. And I say, no. There's no such thing as compromise between truth and lies. I need to realize that. So I'm not continually fooled and pulled into this black hole of sacrifice. And so I need to give up the idea of wanting to be prime creator. Otherwise, I'll keep, you know, but we will keep deceiving ourselves and thinking that we need to, that there's some kind of compromise between truth and lies. That's just self-deception. There's none. Lies are nothing. So what is there to compromise with? There's nothing there to compromise with. There is no lies in truth. The prime creator didn't create any lies, so there are no such thing as lies. So what exactly is it that could be compromised with? Nothing. It's like saying everything needs to compromise with nothing. There's nothing there to compromise with. And we say, well, you need to give something to nothing. That's like saying that zero and a million, let's say, if a million gives, let's say, 500,000 to zero, multiplies zero by 500,000. Let's multiply that by 500,000. What does that come out as? Zero, right? So you can't give anything to zero, really. You can't expand zero-ness. Okay. Mathematically, of course, you can add something, but we're talking about multiplying to get the idea of expansion. Okay, because reality expands. It doesn't lose anything, it just expands. Whatever has already been there always is there. And it's just the vast experiencing, endless experiencing just keeps expanding. It's like perfect richness without losing anything. And if you give truth to someone, do you lose something? Does that cause a loss to you? If you share truth, is that a loss? No, there's no loss. It's an expansion. But if you try to multiply zero times anything, it's still zero. So you can't really give anything to nothing because nothing can expand. There's nothing there to expand. There's no life. There's no truth. There's no reality. There's nothing there. Cannot expand it. Nothing cannot be expanded. So there is no compromise with nothing. Can't be. We simply have to remember reality. And the remembrance, it has to be total. There's no compromise with reality. Less of reality or less real or something like that, no. But remembrance itself can be like a reflection. But the reality itself, there can be no compromise with reality itself. But the belief and faith and remembrance, that can, again, take on familiar form. It's like awakening from a dream. It's still a dream, still not real, but it's a happy dream. It's a familiar dream. It's a dream that familiarizes us and reminds us of reality. But as far as truth goes, you cannot compromise with truth. There's no bargain to be made. Reality is one. There's no bargain to be made with that. It's not, you know, how can you give some of reality to unreality, to lies or unreality? It's impossible. Reality is one. You can't fragment it. You cannot fragment reality. It's impossible to fragment it, so you can't give part of it to anything. It's not possible. So when the ego says, no, give me, I want just a little part of reality, that's asking for the impossible. And the ego says, no, you can make that happen. You can find a way. No, we cannot. We cannot. It's asking the impossible. So we can't. We cannot get caught up in these bargaining sessions anymore. Cannot. That's why I don't entertain these bargaining sessions. I cannot. And I'm sharing with you, everyone, the viewers and listeners, again, reassuring you, you don't have to get caught up in these bargaining sessions at all. And don't get caught up in them now. Do not. You got every right to go as fast as possible right now. Don't let anyone slow you down. Don't, someone will say, hey, you know, you need to bargain with this situation. No. You can't bargain with nothing. The ego's position is nothing, has nothing we want, nothing we will ever want. Okay, not only nothing we want now, nothing that we will ever want. So that encompasses, you know, totality of any bargaining session the ego could ever give rise to. You've already canceled all bargaining sessions in perpetuity, all of them, because the ego will never have anything that we want, nothing. So there's no more reason for any bargaining sessions. Zero times anything will always be zero. There'll never be anything to expand within lies, within denial of reality. There's nothing to expand there. Nothing. Just symbols. But symbols are nothing of themselves. They have meaning of themselves whatsoever. So they'll never have any meaning of themselves. So there's nothing to bargain about, nothing to negotiate about. Cancel all sessions. Right now, and in perpetuity, all sessions are hereby canceled. No more. So the ego's out of luck. The ego has been outed. And so you don't engage the ego anymore. Go as fast as you can. And the ego, being completely insane, will scream, that's not fair. But it's completely insane. It has no idea what is fair and what is not fair. It doesn't have any idea that it's what it's offering in the first place. See, it's up to us to determine what it's offering. Because the ego cannot. It was born of a lie, born of deception, born of nothing. It's the idea that nothing can expand. So it's really, it knows really nothing. It cannot expand. But it you know, it's a belief and a faith and a symbol. So we, you know, we believe it can. But it actually cannot. It's kind of like the ego saying it's not fair that lies cannot gain equal status to truth. Well, unfair to what? The ego is nothing. So how can it be unfair to the ego? We're everything. So believing that we can become nothing is unfair to us. You know, because it's just wasting our time. So to entertain the ego at all is unfair to ourselves. Very unfair. Simply, we're spending time in a meaningless, aimless way. That's not fair. It's not fair to us at all. So again, the ego is nothing. How can you be unfair to nothing? It's not possible. The ego is saying it will be something, so that what, however we're treating it now as nothing may be valid, but it'll be unfair in the future, because when it becomes something, that all this treatment of it as nothing in the past will be seen as unfair. So it uses time that way. It uses the future. The ego entirely is based on the future, uses the future. And again, like I said, be here now. In other words, drop the future. That's very good advice. Just completely be willing for the drop the future and lift the veil on the eternal now. Lift the veil on the loss-free kingdom, which is dwelling. There's no loss at all. So it's like right now. I don't have to say it's right now. It's always going to be this way. Past, present, future, it's always this way. And so you don't have to worry about the future of it. How's it going to look in the future? No, it's going to look like it does right now. Maybe it'll be expanded in the future, but the quality of it is the same. And that is what we have to look forward to in the apocalypse. Apocalypse now, it's coming. Probably just months away at this point. And it's extremely helpful to get a boost at this time, a big boost of positive energy, of feistiness, of lack of fear of the ego's repercussions of the future, what it's going to do to you in the future. I mean, the ego looks at me and says, oh my gosh, in the future I'm just going to barbecue your hide, you know. And you have to see that's a lie of the ego. Because the ego will never have any authority at all, because nothing will never have any authority. The ego says that nothing will become something, even become the greatest authority of all, is simply not true. It's just insanity. It's just an appeal to magic and sanity. That's it. Can we get, it skipped over the be here now. Okay. Just being is enough. Don't have to even worry about time. Just realize that the ego uses time to intimidate. Okay? That's it. And we cower before the ego and see what the ego wants us to see, because it intimidates us with this whole thing about time and saying it's going to become something. So we're literally, what we're perceiving now is this world is what the ego wants us to see. Okay, it's very important to hear this. What we are perceiving is what the ego wants us to perceive. But we can perceive something other than this. Okay, we can perceive what we really want to perceive, free of the ego's intimidation. And that'll be a loss-free realm. The ego, what we're seeing now is a scenario of loss. Okay, vulnerability, loss. That is what the ego wants us to see, and we're seeing it because we're intimidated by the ego, because the ego says in sometime in the future it's going to become something. It's going to become the ultimate authority. It's right now it's nothing, but eventually it's going to become something really incredible, more powerful than the prime creator, more powerful than us too. And therefore we better do what it wants us to do now to brook favor with it in the future. That is its whole deception. And the truth is, it will never become anything, ever. Nothing cannot expand into anything whatsoever. Nothing can ever have any authority whatsoever. The ego will never have any authority. Nothing will never have any authority. Therefore, we don't need to curry any favor with the ego at all. We don't need to see what it directs us to see, what it demands that we see, in order to be quote-unquote fair to the ego, in order to please the ego. We don't need to see that. We don't. We can drop that. We don't need to see it anymore. We can see what we really want to see. So this is the essence of the teaching. This is the essence of a teaching freed up from fear, freed up from intimidation of the ego. Maybe after this video, I'll say, oh my God, what did I say? I'm really in for it now, you know. Oh, the ego's gonna be mad at me. I'm probably shaking in fear, you know. That's the thing. Problem with making these videos is you know, the backlash of thinking, oh my gosh, the ego, you know, what happened? What if, you know, what if nothing became something? Then the ego is really going to barbecue my hide in molasses, you know. But so there is that backlash of anxiety, you know, and so it's not easy to make these videos. I'll tell you. I mean, it's easy right now. But tonight and tomorrow, maybe I'll have second thoughts and say, why did I say that? That's really a dangerous thing to say. You don't want to get on the, you know, you don't want to entirely get on the ego's bad side. You know, at least, you know, cut it some slack. So, gosh, I didn't cut it any slack. You know, what was I thinking? So there's regrets, you know, like that. Buyer's regrets, like, oh my gosh, what did I say? Did I really say that? But, you know, it's important while you have the courage to speak up. And then, of course, you might have some tremors of regret later, thinking, uh-oh, I may have jumped the shark here. His ego's not going to be happy with this. So, you know, it is stressful making these videos, no doubt about it. And it's probably stressful for you to watch the video, because later on you think, oh my gosh, what was I listening to, man? The ego's be really, really upset at me for listening to that. And you'll say, oh no, I don't really believe that stuff, you know. No, I didn't watch it. I didn't really watch it. I need to delete it from my history. That kind of stuff. But it's better to stay strong, because all this what I'm saying to you is true. It's just that we're so accustomed to trying to bargain with the ego, you know, thinking that the ego might become something eventually. Because after all, we are creative, and we tried to create the ego. We tried to create something out of nothing. Reality out of nothing, out of a lie, and we believe in our own creativity, because we think there's nothing we can't create. So we believe that the ego eventually will become something, but it's not true. We cannot make a lie true. There is no truth that will ever come out of a lie. We cannot make a lie something truthful. We cannot destroy even a tiny bit of reality, okay, which is what we're trying to do. We cannot destroy ourselves at all, not even a tiny bit. And so we don't have the creativity to destroy ourselves. We don't have that. But we think that our creativity can do anything. So we fear the power of our own creativity, thinking that eventually we'll be able to make the ego, you know, more powerful than we are. And then it will extract its revenge upon us with all these grievances that it has that we didn't, you know, weren't fair to it. Got nothing but grievances, you know, just stacking up these grievances, a whole storm of grievances, and we think we need to pay for these grievances with sacrifice. That's why all this dark storm is just this massive cloud of vengeance and grievance and vengeance, and to, you know, wipe us out with, you know, without any remorse or mercy. So we have to pay, as if we have to pay the price for being unfair to the ego. You know, the ego is just, ego is slighted about everything. Because it's nothing. Anything that is slights the ego. Okay? Anything. All that is slights the ego totally. And builds up insane grievances. Because the ego's nothing. And so the ego says, how dare, you know, isness be something and I'm nothing. You know? How dare? And so it has this incredible grievance complex, symbolically. You know, in imagination and plausibility. And that this is coming upon the world to, you know, wreak havoc here. And those who think they need to be fair, the ego think, well, you know, the ego says now it's time to pay the piper, and by sacrificing, through the sacrifice, I will have paid for my sins towards the ego, and then I will be released from those sins. The ego will be happy with me, you know. Most of the story, honestly, most of the story about God in this world is really talking about the ego. All the stuff about vicarious atonement, sacrifice, appeasing the wrath of God, etc. That's all talking about the ego. The ego has this, you know, insatiable grievance towards reality, towards truth, because it's nothing but a lie. A lie is nothing. And it has, you know, just this, again, plausible hatred. It could have hatred. This is all just being imagined. But within this dream that we're imagining, the ego is this, you know, has just this insatiable hatred towards life, towards truth, towards isness, what is. And it has this just endless sea of grievances, and it tells us that we have to pay for its grievances, pay off to appease its hatred and feeling of grievance. And the ego tells us there's a way to do that, which is to die, which is to be sacrificed. And the ego tells us that once we agree to be sacrificed, to die, that will appease its extreme anger towards us and grievances, and it will finally drop its grievances towards us. Okay, this is, you know, absolute nonsense. The ego cannot drop grievances towards us. What is nothing, if we choose to believe in nothing, it has to have grievances towards what we are, because we're everything. It's nothing. So there's no way to atone for these grievances, to appease the ego. No way. None. But it has to tell us that there is a way. Otherwise, we'd see through this whole thing and say, wait a minute, you're nothing. You never will be anything. So these grievances are just, again, nothing. I don't have to pay anything off. The Prime Creator has no grievances toward me whatsoever. God, the Prime Creator, has no grievances towards the totality of creation. None. Zero. None. So there's nothing to pay off. We don't need to pay any price to assuage grievances. That's just that's complete insanity to see things that way. That's the ego belief system telling us this is what we need to do. Of course, the ego says you need to sacrifice yourself. And ultimately, the ego says you need to sacrifice your spirit, which is impossible. In other words, the sacrifice of Jesus was only the energy bodies. The spirit was completely untouched. And then the spirit, what did the spirit do? Simply put on some energy bodies again, just reconstituted them through its creativity. And then Jesus' body there was again. Easy for spirit to do that. So the sacrifice, what the ego wants is to sacrifice spirit, which is impossible. What the ego gets is sacrificing energy body. And we think that if we sacrifice our energy bodies to the ego, that then that'll assuage the ego's grievances towards us. Not realizing that energy, all energy is symbolic. Energy bodies are simply imaginary symbolic. And what the ego really wants is to sacrifice spirit, which cannot happen. So we cannot assuage the ego's grievances. It's not possible. Because the ego will say, yeah, you sacrificed all these energy bodies, but I still feel total grievance towards you, so you didn't really, you know, sacrifice the spirit. And what people are doing with some religious people are doing is they're trying to say, no, we sacrificed the spirit. Jesus actually sacrificed it. The spirit was sacrificed, and therefore that should appease your anger towards us, so we should be able to live under your rule happily. You shouldn't have any grievances towards us because you got what you asked for. So this is simply untrue. The ego did not get what it asked for. Did not get the death of spirit. It did not get the sacrifice of spirit. It only got the sacrifice of energy bodies. And the ego's grievances are completely unassuaged. So we cannot live happily under the ego's authority, because it's as full of, you know, murderous rage towards us. Unabated. And actually, the ego is nothing. It has no authority. It has no kingdom. It doesn't even have all this rage. We're simply imagining it. The dynamics of existence of this dream are simply imagining all of this, okay? But this is the dynamic we've been stuck in, thinking that we, you know, if we can just sacrifice spirit, you know, the ego's going to be happy. Well, guess what? We can't sacrifice spirit. Spirit cannot be sacrificed. So that's the end of that scenario, right? And I know that some will understand exactly what I'm talking about. And if you don't, then don't sweat it, because, you know, it's like, people think, oh, my very best chance to escape the ego's wrath, and now I hear it doesn't work. You know, that was kind of frightening. But again, if you understand the Passover principle, then you realize that is the escape from the ego's wrath. It just passes you by automatically. You don't have to appeal to this insane belief in sacrifice, which, unfortunately, somehow the whole Jesus thing got twisted into that. A lot of got twisted into that, not understanding what really took place. So what took place is very simple. I've explained it, you know, over and over in various different ways. And but, you know, the idea is it's turned into this situation of ego worshippers are thinking, if we only accept the death of Jesus, I mean the death of the spirit, if we only accept it, then the ego will be happy with us and say, okay, you believe that spirit can be destroyed, so now the ego is going to go easy on you, you know, and it's going to drop its wrath towards you. If you just believe it, guess what? It doesn't work, because the ego knows it's still nothing. And so the ego says, and then what they stretch it out by saying, well, the ego still feels a wrath, but very soon, at the apocalypse, the wrath will disappear because everybody else has to be destroyed. But those who have been loyal to the ego, they will be saved. You know, those who believe that spirit can be destroyed will be saved from the wrath, and the ego will cast everybody else into hell, and, you know, that kind of thing. It's nonsense, that way of looking at it. And hopefully you've seen exactly, you know, what the situation really is, and you'll be able to go forward with that. What is this on? There you go. So what we're doing here is we're lifting the veil. We're bringing about our own apocalypse, but it's a great apocalypse, a lifting of the veil that has been obscuring truth, which has been obscuring truth, because this whole sacrificial nonsense, Jesus in A Course in Miracles wrote that very, very bitter and nasty belief systems arose from his being here, but that the ego, the loyalist to the ego, simply misinterpreted his purpose here, and instead turned it into vicarious atonement, turned it into a belief that his spirit was sacrificed, and then that should if all who believe in that possibility, that reality, that it did take place, the ego is then going to love them, and they will be put into some kind of new kingdom of the ego. When the ego gains power through the destruction of everything, they will inherit the ego's kingdom, because the ego will say, ah, you're the ones who stood with me and believed that spirit can be destroyed, so now you're going to reap the rewards of that. That's a completely delusional belief system. Yeah. Again, spirit cannot be sacrificed, impossible. The ego is nothing. The ego will never have a kingdom of its own. The ego will never be able to reward anyone for anything. The ego's grievances are unabated, and the only way to escape it is through the Passover principle. The only way to really escape it is to be defenseless, truly have this attitude, the true beatitudes, that automatically cause the ego's grievances simply to pass you by, all its dreams of vengeance, etc., to pass you by, because, again, the ego doesn't see anything being defended, so there can't be any opportunity for loss there. It has to pass by. And then there's an entire realm that has been passed by. An entire realm. Like clouds are just passing the sun, feel the sunflowers by. And the sunflowers are just beaming here, you know. The clouds are full of all this storm and intensity of conflict, etc. But the field of sunflowers are just blissed out. So we can all have the entire scenario of apocalypse, Armageddon, passes by. The apocalypse can be one of us seeing truth, the realm, the lost free realm. We'll be able to even see it, and it will become our experiencing. Become our experience. Will be somehow translated into that realm, and others will see the realm of loss and sacrifice and be translated into that realm entirely, and they will then experience the Armageddon, the terrible end times conflicts and various things that will happen to the realm in the realm of sacrifice, which are going to be very cataclysmic, to say the least. But in the lost free realm, no disaster, no cataclysms, no suffering, no loss, no crime, no sickness, no lawyers, no police, no bureaucrats. Do we need anything like that? Simply to bliss out on the beauty of it and the freedom of it and the safety of it. Eternally safe, eternally invulnerable. We just bliss out on it. Absolutely bliss out on it. And we don't need anything external to accomplish that blissing out on. It's automatic. It's inescapable. We don't need to regulate it, you know. Don't need governments and bureaucrats and politicians and elections and taxes and money and any. No, don't need any of that. Don't need roads and buildings, etc. For us to bliss out on it, we're blissing out on it. When the veil lifts, we will bliss out on it for sure. When the apocalypse comes, we will bliss out on it. Be in bliss. And that day is coming very close. So we're trying to get these videos out here and help lift the veil and get ready for it. Again, this video, Sunflower Field, is 10 minutes to relax. YouTube channel, 10 minutes to relax. Thanks for that, for this great video and Creative Commons. All right, how are we doing? Where are we at right now? We're at a minute 45. I look like Shirdy Baba or something like that, you know. Yeah, this is the lifting of the veil. This is preparing for a lift for the apocalypse. Lifting of the veil. These videos are intense preparation for that. Hearing the truth, realizing you can go in the direction of truth, and letting go of all this complex of lies of sacrifice. The whole belief in sacrifice is nothing but a complex of lies and self-deception. That's all it is. The ego will never become anything. Never. And the whole lie is based on the belief that ego will eventually become something. And the ego says, well, never's a long time. No, it's endless. The ego will never become anything at all. It's endless. We will never, ever be able to destroy even the tiniest fragment of reality. Reality is one. We will never be able to destroy reality. We will never be able to replace the laws of reality. We will never be able to separate from reality. Never, 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 never. Impossible, impossible, impossible. That means forever and ever and ever, endless. There's no way around endlessness. So the ego, spirit cannot get around endlessness. So we cannot create something that somehow gets around endlessness, gets around neverness. Cannot do it. We cannot do it. And we keep trying. And we keep thinking, well, if we just stick with it long enough, we'll succeed. No, we will not. Will not. We can realize that right now. We don't need to go keep us going with the sacrificial belief system, which is coming in this world. You know, and there'll be an opportunity for those who want the sacrificial belief system. There will be a huge opportunity to indulge in that, believing that it's getting on the ego's good side. You know, like it's earning a spot in quote unquote heaven. The ego doesn't have any heaven to give. It never will. So you cannot earn a spot in the ego's heaven through sacrifice. And God's heaven doesn't require any sacrifice at all. You don't need to earn a spot there at all. You're already pre-qualified, entirely pre-qualified for that, you know, glorious country club. Full membership, full rights and privileges. Already have it all. Don't need to qualify. You're pre-qualified. You don't need to earn a spot in heaven. You already are there. The totality is yours already. Always has been, always will be. Can never be taken away from you. Impossible. So, you don't need to earn anything. You don't need to earn a spot in heaven. You're already there. So this whole thing about earning a spot in the ego's heaven, it's a waste of time. And we keep torturing ourselves, thinking that through this torturing ourselves, we're earning a prime spot, some prime spot of real estate in the ego's heaven, you know. We work like crazy in this world, and we get a really nice place. We think, you know, I'm really getting there, really getting there. Of course, everything is completely, we get having this world completely vulnerable. We're completely vulnerable to losing it. When the body dies, of course, we won't be able to grasp any of it, will we? And that these subtle energy bodies that we have, again, are just our own projection of our imagination, that we think that spirit is wrapped up in these. Spirit's not wrapped up in anything. We just imagine it. So we think there's a soul, and this soul is encased in these energy bodies. But the soul, again, is only symbolic of spirit. Spirit's not wrapped up in anything. Spirit is the totality of reality. That's what it is right now and always. It's already that. It's not wrapped up in anything. It's free. It is a freedom of reality, the infinite freedom of reality. right now, always is and always will be. So this whole thing about a soul going on a journey and being wrapped up in these causal body, mental body, emotional body, etheric body, physical body, it's all a dream. It's all symbolic. It's all the whole dance of energy symbolic. What we are is not wrapped up in anything. What we are is not on any journey whatsoever. It's not becoming anything. It already is what it is. So, call off the search. Call off this nonsense. Call off the effort to appease the ego. Call off the effort to earn a spot in the ego's never to be heaven. Never to be kingdom. Don't try to get on the ego's good side. It has no good side. So lift veil to the lost free realm. Let the apocalypse come soon. And it will come soon for sure. But for us, we don't need to fear it at all. In fact, we welcome it. We welcome it. Those who are prepared, they welcome it. Welcome it. You know, because they're the Passover principle. All this whole lost space scenario will pass them by. Be passed by it automatically, and the veil on the lost free realm will be lifted. We lift it just like that. And apparently we're heading towards a time when the ripeness for this is extreme. So we're headed into the ultimate opportunity right now, tremendous opportunity. And we only need to go for it. Go for it. Go for it. It's go time. Let's see if we can wind this down a little bit now. Go back to these glorious fields here. Let me see if I can, as we wind this down, let me throw something in here, if it's possible. There you go. Very great. Okay. So away with those dark clouds, you see. Instead, replace those dark clouds with the light of truth. Our apocalypse can be one of opening an awareness to the lost free realm. So be optimistic, be positive, be engaged with your preparation for the apocalypse. For the lifting of the veils, and realize that the effort we're making is exactly that right now. It's not anything other than that. It is preparation for that, for the apocalypse. There's no harm in saying it. It's helpful to say that because it's absolutely true. It's absolutely true. And it's something that is on tap for us. And we can only do so much, and then there's a rebound, of course, effect where we wonder again, like, what in the world am I doing? Am I crazy to just, I'm risking everything, you know, I'm risking my future, I'm risking my place, kingdom. How crazy could I be? I'm gonna get the least terrible, I'm gonna get the worst place in the ego's kingdom, no doubt about it. Well, you probably won't, because I'll be getting the worst place, so to speak, right? So don't worry about that. Maybe we'll live in the ghetto together, so to speak. But there won't be any such ghetto. There won't be any such kingdom. It never will happen. So don't worry. We won't be dwelling in any ghetto. Egoic ghetto. Won't happen. Won't happen. So, you know, tries to intimidate us, but just brush the ego's intimidation away. Jesus said, get behind me, Satan. You know, in other words, you got nothing to say to me. That's what Jesus said. You have nothing to say to me. Get behind me. He's not even interested in discourse, knowing that the ego is nothing. Nothing's being offered. Waste of time. Get behind me, Satan. You know, got nothing. So let's not be worried. Let's not be worried about some kind of terrible drop in status. You know, we may seem in this world right now not to have great status because the status is being handed out by the ego. All those people who are doing the ego's will and kowtowing to the ego, and the ego's handing out status like candy right now. If you want to have status and, you know, high status in the world right now, just bow and scrape and genuflect to the ego, and the ego will see that you get it. You know, but who wants, like Jesus said, don't lay up your treasures in this world. Forget about that. Lay up your treasures in the place where the moss don't rust, where moss don't eat, rust doesn't corrupt, you know, where decay doesn't happen. Lay up your treasures there. Make that your goal. The lost free realm. Make the lost free realm your goal. And there's not even a question of status, because there's no loss anywhere, and you just bliss out on this fact wherever you are. Wherever you are in the lost free realm, you bless out. You can't help it. There's no such thing as anybody there in a higher or lower rank, you know. Because there's no loss anywhere. You just, wherever you turn, you just see it and you just bless out on it. It's incredible. There's no ghettos there at all. There's no place like where there's, you know, which is better or worse. There's no prime real estate there, you know. None. Because wherever you go, 360 degrees, completely surrounded by no loss whatsoever, an exquisite beauty, and you just bless out. You can't help it. Cannot help it. So don't worry. Don't worry about it. There's no such thing as status there. No such thing as status there. Zoom. All right. Good time to end on a very positive note, on a worry-free note. All right, this has been very great. Did I get to 2 hours? Not quite. That's okay. That's okay. We can wrap it up under 2 hours. How about that? Fantastic. Very great. Okay, that's it for this video.